everyone. This is Bishop T from Recovery Churches of America, and this is my colleague, Lee Duplessis.
Hello.
And we are Sisters on Cinema. So this is part of the series that we're doing called The Psychology of Possession. And as we are talking about this, we're taking different things from cinema. Last time it was Halloween. This time we are focusing on the question, crazy or evil? So we're going to pull up somebody that epitomizes looking at this question, and that is the Joker. Roll that clip. And what do you think when you see this opening of The Dark Knight and it's talking about the Joker? Because to me, this epitomizes the character. So what do you think, Lee, as a psychology person?
I think that the Joker is very deliberate. I find that he is conscious. We know that he knows he's conscious because when they ask him, are you crazy? And he says, no, I'm not. Not only does it make him angry, but he's serious. A lot of his behavior is deliberate. He reads people quite well. He's aware of his surroundings. And he has combat skills. It's really obvious when he pushes the guy's head into the pencil. That's, your ordinary citizen can't do that. You have to have been trained to move that fast, run the body dynamics that way. And so you can see the Joker has combat skills. He holds his gun like he's been trained to do it, short bursts in a focused area. He punches, kicks, and rolls a certain way. And you can tell that he has been under some form of command by the way that he asks people questions when he's taunting them and his torture techniques. He shows a conscious awareness of what makes people tick.
Okay, slow down for a second here. When you're talking about combat training, what makes me think about this is the very opening of The Dark Knight, when the bank robbery goes down.
Yes.
That he's robbing a mob bank. And coming from a town which is known for its mob activity in the past, Chicago, I can tell you, and I've had dealings, and my family has had dealings with the mob. And you did not play with them. There's nothing cute or cuddly or fussy about them and things. So robbing a mob bank would take timing and precision. I mean, when you watch that whole thing go down, that's somebody who really knows what they're doing. So when you bring up this thing about combat training, that's a real revelation because there's so many signs of that in the Joker that just goes right over your head. I think one of the reasons why is that we're used to other Jokers.
Yes.
If you look at the clip, the just quick clip of all the faces of the Joker, that kind of comes into the movie when you're watching it. Even though the director, Christopher Nolan, is not pulling that in, we automatically do. So if you look at the many faces of the Joker, you start thinking, oh, well, he's also this type of Joker or that type of Joker. Roll that clip. So when you look at that, that's what's coloring the way that I saw this movie. I didn't even think about it, but when he's in the jail cell and they're talking about how they searched him when he got busted, what did they say? Just lint? Yes. Knives?
No fingerprints.
Yeah.
No facial recognition. No ID. No evidence the man existed. You don't disappear off the face of the earth. It's just not possible, especially nowadays with all the digital information and technology that we have. So if you don't have fingerprints and you don't have facial recognition and you don't have IDs and you're not in some database somewhere, you're a black op.
Yeah. The government made you disappear.
And you were trained to torture people.
There's no accident on something like this. No. The Joker was created. That's one of the reasons why. Check out when you see The Dark Knight. That's one of the homework assignments that we're going to have for everybody here. Go back and watch The Dark Knight and think about possible military background for the Joker. Notice how he keeps changing his story about how he got those scars. He's not doing it because he's nuts. No. He's doing it to kind of like bring up sympathy according to whoever he's telling the story to. When he tells the story of how he got these scars, and he's talking to Batman's girlfriend, Rachel, he tells the story about his wife and how bad he fell and everything else. When he's talking to someone else, the gang member, and he's busy saying, oh, about my father. My father was a brute, you know, and he cut up my face. You know, why so serious and everything, which has become a meme and everything else. He tailors that story for his audience. And then he does it again when he's talking to Rachel. And at the end, when he's telling Batman, you want to know how I got these scars? Batman says, not really, but I know how you got these. And then he does his little razor things across the guy's face and gets him off of it. Also, notice something else, too. When Batman is fighting the Joker, if we're dealing with some of the other Jokers and things, he wasn't really very good at fighting, but he was able to take Batman down temporarily, but he still was able to get the Dark Knight down. And this is a guy who is trained under ninjas and is supposed to be, according to the whole mythos, he's supposed to be the, you know, the creme de la creme, a martial artist. He's supposed to be able to kick it just by anybody's butt. But the Joker manages to take him down. And also, too, just a little commentary on something. When you see the shot of the Joker from behind, he's got wide shoulders, which means he's got muscles, which means he had to get him somewhere and he had to get him in combat because the way he uses his gun, how he commands his men. You remember the sequence where they're going through, they're going under Wacker Drive, which I've always wanted to see a chase scene done like that. Anyway, remember when the Joker takes out the police cars? What does he use?
He uses a AR. I'm not up on the model of the gun that he's using, but it's an AR. It's an automatic. It's going to do rapid bursts. It's going to have more than 30 rounds in the magazine. So when he does that, he's holding it like somebody who's been trained in combat does, which is short, sharp bursts, focus in at the objects. He knows where to hit the vehicles. He knows what his range is because he doesn't miss. So that's combat training. You don't pick up some form of an AR and just shoot it. They ride up. They're hard to hold on target once you start pulling the trigger for rapid fire. A lot of people don't know that. And so not only does he have the muscle to do it, but he's done it before. So we know that Joker has combat training. We know that he's conscious and aware of his behavior, and we know that he enjoys it. We also notice that when he is handling people about his little story, when he goes to the woman, he handles her poorly. So there's no sense that he had any tenderness for a wife. He's actually eager to hurt her. It shows the way that he flips her head, her face around.
And drops her.
And drops her. So so there's no reality to that story. But he does, like a lot of people who have sociopathic or psychopathic behaviors, he tells you in short, sharp sentences who and what he really is, but you don't notice them in the middle of all that chaos. And he tells you it's a job. He tells you he's not crazy. And he tells you that he's serious. Mm-hmm. So we understand from that he's not angry. A lot of people are telling us that he has PTSD. I see no signs of PTSD. He's not overreactive to the violence around him. He's not hypervigilant. When he enters in that negotiation where he puts the pencil in the guy's eye, I don't see any sign of nervousness, hypervigilance, lack of impulsivity, lack of control because he's too aroused. What I see is cold, deliberate, methodical, and willful. So that's how we know the Joker is not mentally ill. He's not out of control. He's combat trained and he's evil.
So you mentioned something very briefly about sociopath and psychopath. Is there a difference?
There is a difference. In the current DSM, the sociopathic and psychopathic are all under one category, and they have subcategories. But I'm a little old-fashioned, and the reason why I like to do that is psychopathic behavior and sociopathic behavior, to me, the old definition. Sociopaths have groups and tribes, and the reason why they don't function in society is they make their own rules. But they do have a rule. They do have
like
a code.
Like the mob.
Like the mob. Mm-hmm. They have a code. They have a rule. They follow it, and they have territories, and they have homies. Psychopaths don't. Psychopaths have no feeling and no bonding to any human being. They have their ego. That's it. Their ego. And the whole thing that they do is everything to feed their ego. And they can be nonviolent, which is why you see a lot of CEOs have psychopathic behavior, or they can be violent like the Joker. So these behaviors do not mean you're mentally ill. These are behavioral disorders. These are choices of people in moral behavior. They are not because they have a chemical problem or a high trauma problem.
You know, what's interesting about what you just brought up is in the very beginning of The Dark Knight, after the Joker has done his whole robbery thing and stuff, he talks to the mob guy, and the mob guy goes on and on about, you know, honor among thieves and respect, mm-hmm. and everything mm-hmm. else. And, you know, what we believe in, mm-hmm. which is socially, because I'm old school too, which is sociopathic. In their group, there's rules.
Yes.
In their group, there is respect. That's why the guy's so horrified at seeing him off his fellow robbers, because a mob guy would not do that. Not a good old fashioned one. The idea is that you're on my crew. That means I'm supposed to kind of watch your back and you watch mine. And that's why he's saying, what do you believe in? And Joker does that line. Remember, I believe whatever doesn't kill you makes you stranger. Okay?
Yes.
And that's why people will look at him and say he's nuts. No, he's not crazy at all. He is a psychopath.
Yes.
And in my understanding, correct me because this is your field, but my understanding is someone who's a psychopath is a person who doesn't bond with anybody.
No.
And the whole thing revolves around their ego, their wants. Except for one thing, I used to study serial killers. Everybody's got their hobby. That was mine when I was in high school and college. And one of the things that I noticed with serial killers is that they usually only bond with one person. And should that person die, either their hands or the hands of another, they just naturally die, they lose it. You know, I'm thinking about the guy up in Wisconsin they base psycho on, Ed Grun. And I knew somebody that busted this guy. They ended up sitting in a chair that was covered with human skin, and it was a police sergeant. She just happened to sit back, and all her fellow officers started laughing at her. And she's like, what?
Wow.
And they pointed to the chair, and it had mother on there. So it was human skin. And she said, I got up there as dignified as I could, but what I wanted to do was go, oh, my God. You know, but she didn't. She said she played it cool. So I knew somebody that was in on that guy's bus, and he had problems. But the worst of it started when his mom died.
Yes.
And as soon as his mother died, and by the way, he stuffed and, you know, and cured her body and all that. That's when he got totally off the rails. So that's just one thing I noticed.
In Joker's story, we don't see where he loses or transitions to complete psychopathy. We only see the end product. The Joker is trained. He has skill sets. He's done it before. We know this by the smoothness of his techniques. He doesn't make any mistakes. We don't see any signs of remorse or confusion or insecurity at all. We see total confidence, total glee. So many of the scenes that are extra in there with Heath Ledger's kind of ad-libbing, he really brings forth the idea that Joker gets a kick out of doing this and watching people scream and run. And yet he has training to handle somebody in a heavy interrogation situation where, like, he slaps the guy and goes, there, 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 and pets him, which causes the guy to calm down, even though the guy knows Joker's going to kill him. And then he changes his voice like a roar and look at me. Well, that's because this person has done this before, and he's probably had military training. Because he's probably black ops, he also knows how to handle intensive interrogation techniques.
Roll that clip. Joker's behavior, as out of control as it looks to somebody, is not out of control, which therefore means he's not crazy. Okay? He's evil. He is malicious. Yes. He's taken whatever training he has to just basically have fun. Remember the famous line in this movie? Some men just want to watch the world burn.
Yes.
And that's what's going on with Joker. Anything that he's learned really pushes his agenda of wanting to watch the world burn.
Yes.
You know, which in psychological terms, what does that mean when someone says, well, he just wants to watch the world burn?
He's just getting pleasure out of it. This is a person whose pleasure centers are keyed towards negative stuff, hurting other people, watching other people suffer. And we don't say that military people do this because this is an aberrant behavior. And you don't see this very often in military veterans at all, which is what makes the Joker evil. Most veterans have a code, and they have rules, and they have compassion and sympathy, and their combat training doesn't make them evil. But Joker is probably a mercenary. I would say he's probably been hired to do things like this before, and you can tell. He knows just how to cut through. He says, I always know who the squealers are. So we know by watching his behavior through this movie that he's done this more than once because it's fast, it's sharp, it's efficient, it's successful. And once again, because he's evil, you don't see hesitancy, you don't see remorse, you don't see confusion, you don't see self-doubt. You don't see any of that. You see a man deliberate, who's angry, who takes it out on other people, who enjoys it, who gets pleasure from it. And at the same time, we see that he's in pain. We see that he's in pain and that he's tired because you can only do this type of living for so long before even that pleasure isn't pleasurable anymore because you've reached your dopamine levels and they're full and there's nowhere to go. So we see that Joker wants to die because he's glad when he throws him off the roof.
When Batman throws him off the roof.
Yes, when Batman throws him off the roof, he's glad. And when he's standing in front of him, shooting the AR, and the bike is coming for him, and Batman's going to run him over, he's like, do it, do it, do it.
Yeah.
He's not taunting him.
Come on,
him.
Do it.
Yeah,
do
he's
it,
not
do
taunting
it.
Him.
No.
He's wanting him to kill him. And that's why he sought the Batman out, is because Batman epitomizes everything the Joker is not. And so he kind of figures, well, hey, I'm just going to even the books, because he doesn't want to feel guilty.
And one of the things I find interesting in this is the maliciousness of the Joker with putting on toward the end, you have the two ships, one which is filled with respectable people, one that's filled with criminals and things like that. And he tries to get them to kill each other. For what? He's got money. He burns the money. Yes. He does not care about that. He's trying to get everybody to be as malicious as he is. And when the two boats don't kill each other, he's got a backup that he's going to use to blow them up. And as the Batman points out, he says the whole reason you did this is to make people be as ugly as you are.
Yeah.
And this is something that you're going to find whenever Hollywood truly gets serious about evil, because this is a line that we'll find later in The Exorcist, which is, why would the devil do this? Why is this happening?
Yes.
Because he wants people to be so ugly and so twisted that we just despair. We just give up. Just say, oh, the whole world is terrible. And remember, this is what happens in The Dark Knight. Because what does the Joker say at the end? He says, I brought Harvey Dent, the prosecuting attorney, down to our level. You know, he just needed a little push. And so what happens is that Dent becomes the worst version of himself. And that's the Joker's point. He's trying to get people to get to the point where they're unredeemable. And this is the epitome of evil. If you ever wonder why evil is the way it is, it's to bring people down to their lowest points. And I'm going to throw in a little bit of theory on this one. I don't think that the Joker just showed up in Gotham just randomly. I think he's connected to Ra's al Ghul, who wanted to destroy Gotham.
He says, I love this job.
Yeah.
Why do you say that you love this job while you've just blown up the police department and you're driving one of their cars down the road from the back seat trying to wreck it?
Yeah.
Why did you say that? That's Joker is not random in this movie. No, Joker has deliberate behaviors. Everything he does has a reason and an outcome.
And that's one of the things that people don't understand about evil. Crazy is out of control. Evil is always tightly in control, even when it seems like chaos. If we look at Hitler or any other understanding of evil that we have from history or fiction, it always looks like what they're doing is chaotic. There wasn't anything chaotic about Hitler. Hitler knew exactly what he was doing. You don't get ovens built. You don't build concentration camps.
It's not an accident.
Like you wake up one day and say, oh, I think I'll kill Jewish people. No, it was always deliberate. It was always part of a greater plan. And I think that's what's going on with the Joker. I think the Joker was sent by Ra's al Ghul from the first movie in order to destroy Gotham. And he almost did. He almost did. And so the only way they were able to stop that was by doing a lie, throwing Batman under the bus, which then sets him up for the last part of the trilogy, which is Dark Knight Rises, where Bane comes in and takes over the whole city. That city would not have been as vulnerable to to Ra's al Ghul's Bane if it hadn't been for the Joker. That's how it gets set up.
Well, and the final thing that we have is Joker undermined everything that made the city valuable and intrinsic and good.
Yes. And so that's what evil does. When you encounter true evil, it's not an accident. No. Don't pay any attention to the behaviors. Look at where those behaviors are going. And that's one of the things that differentiates possession from a lot of other things. When somebody gets possessed, it's deliberate.
Yes.
It comes in steps. It comes in corrupting not only the person, but everything around it. That's one of the reasons why when a person is possessed, truly, you know, in the theological and psychological sense, it affects the whole environment. It affects other people around them. It affects the animals. It even affects the plants. Why? Yes. Because their energy is so destructive that it takes everything down. And that's the point. It's to take everybody down, or as Batman said, to make everybody as evil and ugly as you are. And that's the thing to keep in mind. So your homework, all you dear viewers, is to go watch The Dark Knight and pay attention to Batman and everything else, because he's the antithesis of the Joker. But pay attention to the Joker and think about this, he's not an accident. He's there deliberately to fulfill somebody's agenda, and the agenda is an evil one. And until you can connect the first one, Batman Begins, and the last one, Dark Knight Rises, with what's going on in The Dark Knight, you don't understand the whole process of evil that's being done in this city. So, any last words?
No, I think we've hit it on the nail on the head. Evil is deliberate.
Yeah, very, very deliberate. And so is possession. So I'm Bishop T.
I'm Lee.
And we are Sisters on Cinema. See you next time.